today. I wanted to talk about an interview that I had last week. I don't know if I guys told you. I did tell you about it. I had it on video. The last video that I had, I said after our talk today, I was going to go do a quasi debate with a Christian. I'm not sure if he was a pastor or anything like that. I'm not here to demonize anybody. So the idea is, I want to give just a quick little background story on like what happened. So we met at NanoCon. I'm going to share my screen. This is a person I met at NanoCon. His name was Pedro. Cool dude. He said over Twitter, hey, do you want to do an interview with me? And I was like, oh yeah, let's do an interview. Because I did an interview with him and it was fun. This is the guy, Pedro, right here. And I'll show you this. Here's an email exchange that we had. This is me getting back to him after Twitter. And I was like, hey, yo, let's do the interview. And he's like, hey, thanks for the email. Basically, I want to do a conversation with you. Let's make the topic, does God exist? And I said, you know, I don't want to talk about God existing, because the issue with that is it gives the implication, if you're talking with a Christian, that there's only two sides of an argument, whether or not a Christian God exists, or if atheism is right, which I feel like biases the conversation, because there's so many different genres of Christianity, and atheism is not even an answer to the question on whether or not a God exists. It's just a question of, do you believe in this God or not? And so I said, hey, if you are an atheist, it might be cool to have just an atheist versus atheist debate on this topic, because that'd be kind of cool. And if any of you guys want to talk about, like, does a God exist as an atheist, we might agree on the idea of that we don't believe in the God, but we might have some really cool, interesting, nuanced, you know, things, points of view that we want to throw out. And I don't think that's shared enough on the internet. Whereas I would love to see a Christian debate another Christian on whether or not a God exists, because that will actually show that a lot of things Christians as a group believe, they agree on unanimously, aren't the fact. And so I was like, hey, Christian, or an atheist on atheist, but I'm not really interested in this. I don't think atheism answers whether or not a God exists in the first place. It'd be nice to really dive deep in this topic. If you're an atheist yourself, then we can have atheist versus atheist. Does a God exist? He says, no, I'm actually a follower of Christ. I was like, aw. Mm-hmm. We were talking about that last show. It was like,
spoiler alert.
Yeah. So I'm like, what does follower of Christ mean? That is like the most, oh, I didn't want to say that in my head, but like in my head, that's the most generic form of Christian that I can think of at this point. But yeah. Still. I mean, like, that is what the textbook definition of general Christian. So he really didn't want to talk about whether or not a God exists. So I said, hey, listen, if you make the talk strictly about atheism, especially as a former atheist, because he did qualify himself as a former atheist, I think it would be really interesting to have the conversation, former and current atheists talk about atheism, because I don't want to spend time, and I say this in the email, I don't want to spend time talking about the capital G God that you really, really are a big fan of. I think, you know, like I think I say here, I feel like otherwise to start an honest discussion on whether or not a God exists, and then focusing the talk on any specific God claim stacks the deck too much in favor of that particular God claim. And I made the example, it's like, it's sort of like being invited to talk about your favorite sports team, so long as it's the 1998 Oakland Raiders. Right? And I was like, my issue isn't even with the roster. I'm just not a dude that worships Desmond Howard. So I'm being cheeky here. And he's like, no, that's great. We can do former and current atheists talk about atheism. I love it. P.S. I don't love it. But I was like, okay, great. So we are agreeing that as a former atheist and me as a current atheist, and we're going to be talking strictly about atheism. Please don't preach at me, basically. And here's like more of my explanation about, like, listen, I'm not interested. I'm happy to talk about gods in the future, but I don't want to have an in-depth conversation about anyone's capital G God, given that each person necessarily is pointing at a different personalized capital G God that they necessarily have a personalized relationship with. Like, if you have a personal relationship with a God, your personal G God might be different from someone else's. And I'm not here to talk about the God claim conclusion. I want to know about how you arrived at the conclusion. Like, that's my whole thing. Like, what's the reasoning that you used to reach that conclusion? If the reasoning is good, I'll believe whatever the conclusion is. But I'm not here to talk about the God and the chapters and all that stuff. And he's like, okay, we're all good to go. I'm like, sounds like a plan. And I can tell you, this was a fun conversation, because Larry even warned me, and I was like, yeah, I know what's going to happen too. I'll break the talk into three parts. We're only going to go to the most interesting one, which is at the very end. So talk, part one, it was like a lot of flattery. It was really nice. It's like, hey man, you're really amazing. You really are amazing. I love your channel. It's so good. I was like, great. Part two, what's atheism, right? Oh, and the second part was, or third part was, thank you for telling me about atheism. Yay. Then at the very, very last 5 minutes, there's the surprise overtime. Overtime where it's like, let me tell you about God. Let me tell you about God. Yeah. My capital G God.
Yeah, like you wouldn't know, man, being a former Christian.
Right. Oh, wow, man, that would have been a big deal. But basically, it's like the conversation immediately transfers into, let me tell you about my worldview. This is about my God, and I'm not preaching at you, but let's start with the book of Job. And then we'll go into the book of Ecclesiastes, and I'll go over some of my favorite quotes. It's very interesting. I'd love to share this conversation with you. And here's the premise that I want to make. My whole philosophy, especially with my street epistemology background and all that stuff, is I believe I can talk to anyone about anything. There's a manner of how you have those kinds of conversations. And one of the biggest things about having those conversations is consent. And you'll see a lot of times when Gary does this, when I do this, when Larry does this, is that when we have a conversation with someone, we settle on a topic and then we ask, is it cool if we talk about this for, you know, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, whatever? Or like, can we talk about this? Can I record this conversation? Would you mind if I post it? There's always a back and forth exchange. And it's never formatted in the sense of, and now I would like to talk about my worldview. Blah, 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 blah. Now we're going to talk about Ecclesiastes. Blah, blah, blah. It's like, hold up. There's two people in this conversation and we both need to be on the same page or at least consenting to have the conversation that's being thrown out.
Yeah, otherwise, I'd ask him if he's going to pass the plate.
That's so a surprise overtime.
Yeah.
So anyway, can you guys see my screen? Is there anything blocking the way? Yeah. Is there anything blocking the view? Good. All right. So I think this is the part where he does mention that we are going to be talking about atheism.
So before we go to the topic today, which is former and current atheists talk about atheism.
Yeah.
I just would like to say.
Right. We're going to be talking about atheism. I'm skipping all the way. The first three thirds of this are actually really good. And I'm going to be posting that on my channel as well as my Patreon. So you're free to check that out. But what I want to get to is the interesting part where I start dying on the inside.
So we can all die on the inside?
I speak up for myself. And this is the part, This is why I want to share it with you. Because there's a lot of times where I'm like, no, you agree to talk about this. We're talking about this. And I want to know feedback from you guys. Am I being too harsh? Is this fair? Stuff like that. And I'll feel free to say pause anytime. I'm looking for the part where the conversation transitions, and I'm looking for when he starts going from smiles to like.
Well, so I'm just, it just puzzles me a little bit. Look at the facts that some people might think that just not knowing could be, a bad thing. In fact, and now, Ty, I actually want to talk a little bit about God, if you don't mind.
Remember, we were talking about atheism, and this is like the literally opposite of the thing that we agreed to talk on. So like, it was like atheism. Let's talk about God. Like,
save you, man. He can't miss up on an opportunity to save your soul. That would be.
I know. And that's the thing. It's like, I know he's coming from like a good place, but it's also a cheater. Cheating perspective.
Taking advantage of your goodwill.
Yeah. And I also feel like it implies we soon get to the part where it's like, I want to tell you these Bible verses. Like, I don't want to hear these Bible verses. Like, well, we just had a conversation about atheism. You should now listen to my Bible verses. Like, no, you agreed to have a conversation about atheism. Now you're exhibiting like the privilege of, you know, like this Christian idea that now that you say something Christian related, I have to listen to it. And that's not what I'm about. You're literally talking to the one person or maybe the one small group of people that don't want to hear that stuff that you want to say. So
we've heard it a thousand times.
I know. I believe it or not, I know what the Bible has in it. All right. Anyway, preach at me.
Yes, I'm not going to. Not at all.
All right.
So I'm gonna talk about my worldview. Okay. I'm just gonna talk about this just a little bit.
Okay.
So for
and I think from for, here it would have been a lot better if the question was formatted. Would you mind if I talk about my worldview rather than I'm gonna talk about my worldview?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That's the biggest distinction. And that takes you towards more SC versus just let me preach at you or just let me say things at you and deal with it. You know, yeah. And if you don't like it, too bad. You're going to hell, right?
What can I say? It's very unprofessional.
For a Christian, and I know, and I'm very open to hear all that. Yes.
Just one thing. If you were a Hindu, if you were a Jehovah's Witness, if you believed in Thor, I wouldn't care about the God that you believe in. I'm only interested truly about the manner of how you are able to substantiate the claim through whatever reasoning process you use. Like, I just want to know the reasoning process. Because if it's a reasonable reasoning process, I'll believe in whatever God is at the end of that tunnel too. Mm. But if you tell me, if, for example, you spend the next 20 minutes telling me about, like, I was raised here, this terrible thing happened to me, and then I had an awakening, and this God that just really showed me, was like, that's great. What is the reasoning that you use to get to that God claim? Because stories from tradition don't really move me. I have documented channels of me having these kinds of conversation. It sounds like I'm not convinced and you are convinced. I understand what you're convinced in. How did you become convinced?
Okay, so first of all, I can see how you have had many conversations about this, and you're just kind of structuring the conversation before it happens because you have had it many times.
I've had it many times, and we only have like 5 minutes left in this.
Oh, I understand. Well, just
so let me just tell you about my God belief while we got phone. It's like, oh my God.
No, actually, Ty, let's do something. Let's do something, because I think that was a...
And I'm trying to play it light and
nicely done.
I'm trying to hint, like, hey, this isn't cool to do this at this last stage. And I'm also just trying to say, like, hey, if you want to format the conversation where you can talk about God belief, at least just tell me what convinced you first. And maybe down the road we can get to that. But we have 5 minutes. If you want to do like a quick little chat, SC style, or at least figure out what your epistemology is, just tell me what convinced you about the God belief. And that starts, I feel like, the escalation of, well, you're not letting me talk about what the thing I want. It's like, you don't have my consent to talk about the thing you want. You invited me to talk about this thing that we both wanted. Mm-hmm. We're on a show together. A
salesman has to control the conversation. That's one of the things when I was in sales. Like,
oh, really?
Really pitching it. You know, you have to control the conversation. You have to control the conversation in order to persuade the person, in order to believe that they need to buy what they are selling you. So I began to, once I became not religious anymore, I began to recognize these same tactics in apologists and evangelicals and pastors and just common religious people.
Mm. Larry, I want to shake up the format real quick before we get into the more heated parts of this talk. Would you mind if we did the break and then the news after this video explanation?
No, that's fine.
Cool. So why don't you take us out real quick, and we will be literally right here.
Okay. This is WOZO Radio 103.9 LP FM live right here in Knoxville, Tennessee, this Sunday morning, June 7th. It's about 11:30 a.m.
Nice.
We'll be back in just a minute.
Pew, 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 pew. Digital Free Thought Radio Hour 103.9 FM. Simply the best. Okay, mm-hmm. Cool. Let's get back to this video. We're about to wrap up. So we're getting to the part where this is an interview that I had with a Christian.
You're going to finish the video and then I'm going to give the
exactly. News. Okay. Yeah. And I think I'll be done maybe about 5 minutes. Maybe all right. Yeah, that's fine. 8 minutes. Yeah.
That is a beautiful question. What I was trying to do before answering your question. I don't know.
Sure.
Perhaps we can do this another time.
Sure.
What I wanted to do is not convince you that God exists. I want
you to tell me what convinced you, and I'll leave it whether or not it convinces me as my follow-up question.
But okay.
You can concisely tell me what convinced you in a God. Like I said, I have these conversations in 5 minutes anyway.
Okay.
What convinced you that a God was real? What convinced you that a God is real? Let's get straight to the point.
Okay. Well, before going there, I really want to actually make the point about not knowing how important that is for me as a follower of Christ too. And I know that as soon as I say,
so before we go to the place, I really don't want to go.
Yeah, I'm being hijacked.
Yeah, you also hear a lot of times, I'm not preaching at you, but God would love to have a relationship with you.
Follower of Christ. There's a whole myriad of questions that come.
Yeah, I always wonder, you're sitting down, you haven't moved anywhere. Is Christ not moving either? Like, who are you really following, really?
There you go. That is that is an analytic perspective about nations and linguistics. But let me tell you about why. I'm not preaching. I'm just talking about my worldview, because you were talking about the not knowing.
Yeah.
And you want to know the reasoning. Actually, I didn't pursue that. I wanted to know also the reasoning why you actually describe best models in order to describe reality. And when it comes to reality, you don't think that reality might be, I don't know if it's fair to say important. I don't know if you would say it that way, but it
might be overrated. Might be what I'm saying. Yeah.
Okay. So overrated. So
yeah,
that is kind of a reasoning that would.
So, he got caught up on the idea that I said, like, reality might be overrated. Not saying that it's useless. It's that science is not about giving you reality. It's about coming up with a model to explain how reality works. Mm-hmm. And that pursuit is really useful because it allows us to apply it to things that might be objectively true or things that may not be, like, you know, video games or Google Maps, which uses a flat Earth model. It's just a flat 2D map. It doesn't predict the curvature of the earth when you go from here to McDonald's, because it's more useful to just say point A, point B, it's going to be about 7 miles, right? And like, as long as it's a useful model, we can get some really useful data out of it. And the difference between the usefulness and the objective truth of it could be nominal. So to that point, the objective reality could be slightly overrated, but we at least have this really useful way to like do stuff and like interact with people and come up with models of reality. He hooked on that and he was like, okay, so if you don't know, if you think reality is overrated, let me tell you what isn't overrated. God. And if you don't know, and I know that I don't have the thought process of atheists doesn't know what objective reality is. Therefore, Christians do, because we have the one true compass, which is God. Let me tell you about this other model that you could use and follow. And we got caught up on that a little bit. I'll get to the point where he introduces the book of Job and then skip past that, because I'm just politely waiting through him to be done. And then when he's done with the book of Job, he goes into Ecclesiastes. I'm like, we got to stop. This is not cool.
Thing. Okay, so I would like to know that as well, because if not, if I would stay with the definition of your definition of science and how it kind of leads to thinking that reality is overrated, I wouldn't believe either the way you talk about science.
Yeah, and I mean that in a cheeky way. It's sort of like the pursuit of trying to figure out what your first kiss felt like. It's just like,
yes.
But if you build a machine, like a time machine, to figure out what your first kiss is like, I'm like way more interested in the time machine than that stupid moment in high school
where
you kiss Michelle Andrews, who had like braces and you cracked teeth because you forgot about that because of nostalgia. But you build a time machine, that's way more interesting. So you learned your first kiss, but like, this is overrated compared to the time machine. Like, the pursuit of science is always going to be something more interested than these facile moments that we're stringing together and calling
So what I wanted to say is that in my worldview, when it comes to not knowing, that is actually something that in our state of being, as it is described biblically, and I know that I'm saying many things that would bring forth many questions, but just hear me. What I want to say about the fact that I think that not knowing is actually our nature, is there are two moments. I'm not preaching. I'm just talking about my worldview here. There are two moments in the Bible that are beautiful for me and for many people, which is, first of all, we have the book of Job, allegedly the oldest book in the Bible, where Job is asking for 37 chapters the reasoning why something so evil has happened to him. He's not up to 38, and when it comes to God as answering this question, God actually doesn't answer the question. God does is to widen the perspective of Job, right? He says, you're thinking about this, but what about this? That you need this in order for that to happen. You need this, and you
so
need this.
I'm skipping past this. It's pretty long, and I'm being polite listening through it. But his idea is that the book of Job is like an example of a guy who doesn't know, but the real answer is because God does exist, and he's just testing. Which, in my opinion, is like one of the grossest examples of like the behavior of a deity that's supposed to be benevolent.
Right,
pick on his own followers. Larry, you want to follow up on that? Because I know you got some beef on this.
So. And then mock them for questioning. Like, if you like, how dare you even ask the question? That's kind of how he treated Job.
Yeah.
Like, who the heck are you?
And many
literally hanging out with the devil.
Yeah, think that God killed his family and his children and all that stuff and then gave them back to him.
No, not the same one. Just more women.
That's my point. They gave him a new wife, a new family, et cetera, et cetera. he still lost his original wife and family mm-hmm. and property yeah. and all that good stuff. And it was all due to a bet with Satan. So God
exactly. and
Satan were just playing with the lives of his followers, yeah. especially his true believers. Mm-hmm. It's a terrible story.
It's a really, really rough story to pull anything beautiful from. And right. it speaks to how into the Kool-Aid we're already in.
Indeed.
Right.
Hey, Boudreaux, welcome. It's good to see you. It's
and you're muted.
Hey, Boudreaux. Hey, guys.
Hey, yeah. Boudreaux, welcome.
Just as I was... quick, oh, go for it. Go for it.
Yeah, when you guys threw me off when I joined, I saw two ties, and I was like, the cloning worked. Yeah. Finally.
Finally, there's still with me. So this is the debate that I had last week with Christian. I didn't want to have a conversation about Christianity. He said he was a former atheist, so I was like, hey, current atheist, former atheist, let's talk about atheism. And we did for like 55 minutes, and then at the last 5 minutes, he's like, let me tell you about God. And I was like, did you ask me if I want to talk about God? Because I've made it explicitly clear in emails and Twitter, I don't want to have a conversation about God. I want to have a conversation about atheism. He's like, well, you talked about atheism for 55 minutes. Let's talk about God. And I was like, no, you invited me to a conversation about atheism.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have my consent to talk about God. If you want to have that conversation, at least tell me what convinced you. But don't just start preaching at me. And he's like, okay, fine, I won't preach at you. But the beautiful book of Job yeah. is where I'd like to begin. And then, and you can see my face right now. It's like, oh, no, here we go. And he's already lost. He's already lost in it. So let me skip a wee bit forward. I think there's a point where it's like, this is a lot longer than I expected. Sorry about this, Larry. Let's say I'm aware of the story. What does it mean to you?
Okay, so this is one point, and I'll finish the other one. And then there's a beautiful verse in it.
Gary, you might like that as an approach. I would say it a little more politely because I'm a bit, you know, drawn out. But like when someone starts to say, like, I have this 14 long chapter recital that I want to give you, it's like, okay, I understand. But what does that mean to you? What does it speak to your heart, depending on right. what you're talking to? It's a good yeah. way to get past memorization regurgitation.
Especially, and I think you're referring to the chat I had with the two elders.
Yeah, where are the exactly. story? What does it mean to you?
Okay, so this is one point, and I'll finish the other one. And then there's a beautiful verse in the Ecclesiastes that goes,
I believe you, but what does it mean to you?
So let me say where the okay. verse goes.
Do you realize it's not like you're talking to a person who hasn't read the Bible? It's right. that I just don't want to sit and go over Bible verses. Why don't you just tell me what it means to you? Because at okay. least that's the interesting part of the conversation for two people who are talking to each other. Does that make sense?
It doesn't.
Why doesn't that doesn't. Make sense? Like, why doesn't that make sense? Why can't I just tell you Bible verses right now? Like, aren't you a person that loves Bible verses? Like, no, like, I'm literally not that person, and you invited me to have a conversation about not that. How does it not make sense to you? Anyway. Mm-hmm.
Why okay. why would that make sense for me?
There is a multitude of people in the world, billions of people who would love to talk with the Bible about you, and you have direct access in your mind.
Yeah.
To an all-powerful being that you believe in who would love to talk to you as much as you want. But yeah. unlike those conversations, I'm not asking you for 10% of your paycheck, and I'm actually listening to you. Yeah. So you're talking to a human being that has a mortal short period of time. And, you know, my time is valuable. And I think I've made it clearly ahead of time that I don't want to talk about Bible verses. Mm. I want to know what they mean to you. If yeah. you can't get there, maybe we can set this up as a different time, but this isn't the conversation I signed up for. So again, I'm opening up the window and I'm still staking my ground because there is that, Boudreaux, the idea of the show is like Christian privilege. Like, I'm not just going to sit here and have you recite Bible verses at me or preach at me. And at the end of his like Job talk, he was like, and let me tell you how beautiful God is. Listen, it was just the idea that, you know, Job didn't understand. It's like, that's a terrible story. I'm not going to say anything. Now, when he moves into Ecclesiastes, he's like, I can't take this anymore. Like, I have to speak up. And so I think it's worthwhile that if you are an atheist, don't be passive when, you know, mm-hmm. Christian privilege is being pushed on you. It's okay to speak up and express yourself like, hey, you don't have consent to push me through this right now.
Right.
I think that ends this. We can talk yeah. about this later on. Boudreaux, what do you think?
So just is anybody else distracted by the need to play the game of find the different things in the two pictures? Ty has a red shirt on that one and a blue shirt on that one. I'm looking in the back. The guitar's still there.
Isn't that the easiest game? Oh, there's a guitar in the background? Where?
Oh, ukulele right by your door.
Between me and this version? I thought you meant between like this guy and this guy. I was like, it's easy because everything's different. Oh, okay. No. That's easy mode.
That's right. That was so funny.
That's
funny. That's really interesting, this conversation with this guy. I gotta hear the beginning part now.
Let's wrap up, and then we can get into news.
Oh, I see what you're saying. So you just don't want to talk about... We have talked about a little bit about the worldview of atheism.
Yeah.
When it comes to talking about where my worldview finds a foundation, you don't want to talk about it.
No, because you invited me to a talk about atheism for 55 minutes, for an hour, really. I was not invited to a talk about your worldview. And for you to switch it around in the last step and be like, oh, well, you want to... It's like... If I go out with someone to Taco Bell, right? And then was like, hey, you want to go to Taco Bell? I was like, sure, I go to Taco Bell, but I got to go to work tomorrow. It's like, okay, that's cool. We go to Taco Bell, we come back, and it's like, when I'm ready to go to work tomorrow, he's in my car. He's like, let's go to work. It's like, you don't work where I work. What are you doing? It's like, I get to work. I get half your paycheck now. It's like, no. It's like, dude, we're married. I'm going to sleep in your bed. It's like, no, we agreed to Taco Bell. And that was it. You don't have my consent for any of this. We didn't agree on any of that. Like, what part of that?
But moreover, he wants you to go to his work.
Oh, yeah.
Well, you know, it's like the whole conversation about the atheism thing is really just his extended segue into his proselytizing, right?
Right.
And I'm not standing up for it. Also, it's like if, you know, when people leave their religion, it's a very traumatic experience a lot of times, right? So like if I was a soldier with PTSD, right? And I'm on a conversation with someone who was like a former soldier or whatever. And he's like, hey, let me tell you about my loudest grenade sound effect noises that I love to make with my mouth. And I'm like, please don't do that because that's really going to stress me out. It's like, well, I heard you talk about your stuff all the while. Now I want to talk about myself. It's like, no, dude, that's not cool. Like you don't understand the idea of one, being a good host, two, consent, and three, the trauma that like people who actually leave Christianity or religion and end up without faith might still be dealing with. And that's like a really sensitive topic. So for you to say like, hey, I'll agree to talk to you about atheism for 55 minutes, but when I preach at you at the end and you don't want to hear it, that's your
problem. That's more
like,
Christian privilege right there.
That's more Christian privilege right there. Anyway, let's see.
I think that
I would happily talk about what convinced you that a God was real. But if it wasn't that Bible verse, then I don't care about it because that's not what obviously got you to your God belief.
Yeah, but we were not talking about that, Ty. I just wanted to make a point how Christians are in a state of being where we actually don't know, and not knowing is a beautiful thing. But you seem not to let me finish what I'm trying to say. So perhaps we can talk about that later.
Maybe another time because
it makes me a little bit sad that
you made him sad, Ty.
Yeah, I think his idea is like, hey, you're a guy that talks to anyone about anything, yet you won't let me talk about religion. I'm like, there's a method to the madness of listening to anyone talk about anything. And it's not you be quiet and let the other person vent at you. It's called street epistemology. And the very, very first rule in my book of how to do SE is keep it positive. You know, one, keep it positive. Two, make it a conversation. And then three, try to let the other person think for themselves, right? And when if you're not keeping it positive because the other person's getting uncomfortable, you're failing at any attempt to make an actual connection with another human being. Second, if you're not making a conversation, conversations go both ways necessarily. It's not just me telling you things like, here's my worldview. I'm not preaching, but I'm just going to tell you what my worldview is. I'm not trying to convince you. Just listen to me. Like, that's not a conversation. And then three, you're not letting me think. You're just letting me listen to you. And that's not cool. So like in all three pillars of how to do SE, this is failing. And I'm politely telling him on multiple occasions, please don't preach at me. Two, let's talk about this later. Three, this is what we agreed on. Please stop. And no, I won't let you finish. So deal with that. Like, but, and if you want to keep this up for 5 minutes, fine. But at this certain point, our time's going
to
be up.
That's, you just don't want to hear about something, because if we all approach conversations this way, then we couldn't talk about
to anyone. Certainly wouldn't want to color the whole conversation, but we did agree in text that this would be a conversation between a former atheist and an atheist about atheism.
Yeah.
And you did say at the last minute that you want to talk about God, and I'm totally fine with that. But my interest in God conversations isn't the holy book, the verses that you like, because I really care about what it means to you. Mm-hmm. And the door's still open if you want to talk about, this is what this verse means to me. But I don't want to sit down and talk about the 35 chapters Job wrote or this verse that you want to recite. Just tell me what it means to you.
Yeah,
and if that would change if you didn't have that, what would change about you if you didn't have that verse?
Yeah.
That might be a better conversation for the future. I think right now, maybe we should just work on disciplining ourselves on staying focused on what the agreed upon conversation was. And if you want to make a conversation about God in the future, I'll show up there, but I want to be honest with you. My point, even when I'm doing SE, is not to figure out how much you love your God. It's to figure out how you came to your God conclusion.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And my point is not to challenge your God belief or challenge you personally. Mm-hmm. I'm only challenging, and you have to give it to me. Like, a conversation takes two people to have this. You have to give me the reasoning that you used to get through the God belief. Elsewise, mm-hmm. I'm not interested in having that conversation. And then you're just forcing me to listen to you.
Yeah, and that's okay. Not cool. Yeah, definitely. I'm not forcing you to do anything. And at the beginning of this conversation, we before we press the record button, yeah. We also say that sometimes conversations lead us to talk about things that we go on a tangent.
Yeah, that's really bad. That's like a bad warning. That's like saying, hey, man, or like going up to a girl in a bar and being like, hey, I'll buy you a drink and whatever happens, happens.
Yeah. Right. This is the small print.
Yeah. Hey, it's not my fault that this conversation led to a place that you specifically said you didn't want to go to.
I feel like there's like some
somehow your fault. I just can't articulate it at the present time, man.
There's something poetic about the fact that he used tangent when you think about geometry. Religion and atheism are far from tangential, you know? Like, yeah. I mean, he should have said perpendicular. That would have made more sense.
Oh, that'd be nice. That'd be nice.
Totally okay. Separate.
Yes. We got less than conversations.
We got like 1 minute left. Let's finish this up.
You mentioned about yourself when you talked about video games. So I think that nothing is happening here that is not fair at all. But
cool.
I actually wonder if you not wanted to hear that just side about, not me, because I'm not important anymore.
Why don't
anymore.
You just set just up the conversation that way? We'll do it in the future and you can set up the conversation that way and I can show
definitely,
up.
Definitely.
But not this conversation because we're already out of time.
Yeah. Well, time. Thank you very much. I think that's...
And that was it. Listen, I just want to make the point clear. This isn't the first time I've had this happen to me. And in each case, I've done exactly this, where it's like, you don't have my consent to talk about this. Either stick to the thing that we agreed on, or this conversation's more or less over. We're more or less already out of time.
Oh, I love it. I think it's great. Yeah,
and I'm being cordial. I'm being nice. And I'm keeping doors open. Mm-hmm. But I'm not here to listen to your Bible verses. I'm not here to tell you, listen to about why your favorite God's your favorite God. I want to know about the things that we talked about or the things that we agreed to talk about, or at least your reasoning to arrive at a conclusion, not the conclusion itself. And it's not an attack on you. It's just, I want to figure out the most reasonable way to arrive at conclusions and you're not giving it to me. So what's this conversation about? That's basically it.
He's telling you what he believes instead of why or how he reached it.
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah, I'm going to be posting the full interview on my channel. You'll be able to see that. I think the very first three parts are still really good. The ones about atheism. And then it was only that last 5 minutes where it's like, well, you won't really talk about Christianity. It's like, of course not. Fair warning to anyone else who wants to have a debate with me. It's like, we're going to have it on what we agreed to talk about. And that's it. Anyway, what's news? Local news. Let's do it.
Well, just want to talk about the local atheist groups, free thinking groups here in Knoxville. First.